streets. And it's an ambitious goal because this institutional violence is prevalent. Just about this percentage family. And when I say institutionalized violence, I mean this is a special brand of violence. It's not your everyday violence. This is violence that's backed up by the institution of government, and therefore it's different from normal violence, and that it's seen as legitimate in the eyes of many Austinites, many Americans, many people across the world. It's legitimate violence, which means it's different, and it allows a certain class of people to have special rights and privileges, seemingly special rights and privileges that the rest of us aren't allowed to have.
Okay.
For example, if I were to walk up to one of you this afternoon and give you a straight shot to the stomach, maybe pull out a baton and crack you in the back of the head because I asked you to ID yourself and you refused to do so, I would get arrested and thrown in jail and charged with assault. If a police officer were to do that, they call it, keeping the peace, ensuring officer safety. He was resisting. He wouldn't answer my questions. I had to crack him in the back of the head. If I were to walk up to you with a gun pointed at you and say, give me the contents of your wallet right now, it would be called theft. I'd be thrown in jail. If a police officer does it or a judge does it, it's called collecting a fine, right? It's called paying your debt to society, whatever that means. If I were to show up behind you in your vehicle, pull you over, come up to you with guns drawn, and proceed to take your car from you and leave you stranded on the side of the road, it'd be called Grand Theft Auto. But if a police officer does it, well, I had that same thing happen to me in Muskogee County, Oklahoma. Driving through Muskogee County on my way to Kansas City to participate in a Liberty conference up there, and I was pulled over by Muskogee County Sheriff's Department, who must have been involved in some sort of drug interdiction program because they were looking for trouble. They pulled us over because I was driving my fiance's Ford Escape, which is registered in Missouri, or at least was registered in Missouri about 3 years ago. You see, Missouri requires people who own vehicles in their state or that are registered in their state to pay property tax on the car. So even though she had paid the car off, worked hard right out of college, they were still trying to charge her about $500 a year. So naturally, we refused to pay the $500. But as a result, driving through Muskogee, Oklahoma without tags, I was pulled over. The police officers came with their sidearms exposed, and under the threat of violence, they stole my car. They did theft, but I certainly saw this theft, and they left this sitting on the side of the road in the middle of the night with a whole trunk full of stuff that we were going to be selling at this Liberty conference. We had to walk up the road. It's a very unsafe situation. And I had an opportunity to tell a joke to one of the sheriff's deputies there. These are classic slack-jawed Oklahoma folk. No offense if anybody's from Oklahoma. But they come up to the side of the door and they say, now I'm going to have you roll your window up and we're going to bring a drug dog around. And I said, well, do you all have the right to do that without any reasonable suspicion? We don't have any drugs in the vehicle. He said, here in Oklahoma, we can do that. And we were recording him from inside, so he looked into the camera when he said that and gave like, we can do that. He was proud of what they could do there in Oklahoma. So they brought the drug dog out, the drug dog failed, pulled us out of the car, said they're going to impound it. And of course, I'm engaging in, a nice little peaceful discourse with these guys, letting them know how terrible they are for violating my rights, leaving me on the side of the road stranded. And I had the opportunity to tell a joke to one of the officers. So I say, hey, can I tell you a joke? He says, sure. I say, what's the difference between a highwayman, which is your typical highway robber, the difference between a highwayman and a law enforcement officer? He says, I don't know. And I said, well, at least when the highwayman steals your stuff and violates your rights, he doesn't tell you he's doing it for your own good, like the police do, right? They're violating their rights, they have these special privileges, and they claim to do it for our own good. Well, he didn't get the joke, so I proceeded to explain it to him for the next 5 minutes. But it just demonstrates, again, there's two classes of people. There's those that commit crimes and get prosecuted, and there's those that commit crimes and get promoted. And I don't know what it is. I mean, is it the shiny badge that they wear that gives them these extra rights? If you ask me, there's a few factors that contribute to them having these extra rights and privileges in society. One of them is that people have given the institution of police and law enforcement in general, where sheriffs or the FBI, they've given them a monopoly, meaning they're the only ones that can use legitimate force. They can initiate force against peaceful people, even when there's no victim. Someone's just cruising down the road and fails to signal. Someone's smoking marijuana, for example. Someone's giving someone a haircut and they haven't asked permission in the form of a license first. Violence is initiated against these people. And it's because we create these monopoly institutions that are called government. And some of these people subscribe to this idea that we should give up some of our rights in order to have protection and security. And when they give up their rights to have protection and security, they're given certain promises by the man, the government, the establishment, the city of Austin Incorporated, state of Texas Incorporated, United States of America Incorporated. They say, don't worry, you can give up some of your liberty for security. We'll keep you safe in the form of the police, but there's going to be certain checks and balances. Should some of these police that enjoy a monopoly on the legitimate use of force start to abuse the people? They say there's a system of checks and balances. In the city of Austin, they call that system of checks and balances one of the aspects of it, the office of the police monitor. So earlier, a lot of people raised their hand and said they've been abused. I've been abused by police myself. So you go to the police and you say, hey, you know, I was abused by one of your officers and I didn't much appreciate it. They say, well, we have a system in place that you can go through to file a grievance. It's called the office of the police monitor. So you go to the office of the police monitor, they found my complaint unfounded when the officer lawfully arrested me for reporting it, and then proceeded to harass my fiance and several other women and remove me by measuring vacancies from the office.
So here's some words of wisdom from John Bush, good guy, great activist, good speaker. You can watch the whole event today, Peaceful Streets Assemblies Police Accountability Summit on Ustream. They're streaming it. Just go to ustream.com and search for Peaceful Streets Assembly Project, or it's ustream.com/channel/peaceful-streets-project. I'll also be putting updates here at quick.com/coplock from time to time. But shape it up to be a real good event. A lot of diverse folks here, a lot of people, a lot of doers, a lot of activists, and it's cool. It's really cool to see. But stay tuned, and more coming soon.